Damn, they were fast tonight.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
I'm Jordan Klinger, an attorney at McIntyre Law. The decision to hire an attorney after you've been injured is important. The decision on who to hire is even more important. At McIntyre Law, we will settle a case if the offer to our client is fair. Partial justice is no justice at all. At McIntyre Law, we are committed to obtaining full justice for our clients. Contact McIntyre Law at 405-917-5200 or visit us at McIntyreLaw.com.
I am Conor McGregor, multiple weight MMA champion. I'm a fighter and I've been through many battles in the octagon. Many consider my fights in the octagon heroic, but the real life heroes are those men and women who fight to protect us every day. The real life fighters, the real life heroes, are the firefighters and police officers. These first responders are true heroes because these brave men and women put themselves in the line of danger every single day protecting us all. The Tunnel to Towers Foundation ensures that first responders from fire, EMS and police departments who are killed in the line of duty with young children have a home without the burden of a mortgage. They are my heroes. They need our help today. I'd like to ask you to join me in donating $11 a month to support their efforts. Your $11 a month honors and supports our first responders. Please call now at 1-844-BRAVEST or visit tunneltotowers.org.
At the LASIK Vision Institute, we know LASIK is a big decision, and every one of our patients is unique. That's why we customize your LASIK journey to you.
I only have a certain budget.
No problem. Right now at the LASIK Vision Institute, get 20% off LASIK when treated in April. That can be over $900 off when treating both eyes, plus guaranteed financing options. So visit GetLVILASIK.com today to start your journey towards 2020 vision.
Must mention this promotion to be treated in April of 2024 to qualify. 20% off standard price of Wavelight procedure. Cannot be combined with any other offers. Go to GetLVILASIK.com for details.
At the LASIK Vision Institute, we know LASIK is a big decision, and every one of our patients is unique. That's why we customize your LASIK journey to you.
I'm so busy right now.
We offer a mix of convenient days and times, including 30-minute virtual appointments to fit your schedule.
I would love it, but I have astigmatism.
We treat thousands of patients with astigmatism every month with great outcomes. The LASIK Vision Institute is making your journey towards 20/20 vision all about you. So visit GetLVILASIK.com today to start your LASIK journey.
Hi, I'm Mike, founder of DollarShaveClub.com. What is DollarShaveClub.com? Well, for a dollar a month, we send high-quality razors right to your door. Yeah, a dollar. Are the blades any good? No. Our blades are f***ing great. Each razor has stainless steel blades, an aloe vera lubricating strip, and a pivot head. It's so gentle, a toddler could use it. And do you like spending $20 a month on brand-name razors? 19 go to Roger Federer. I'm good at tennis.
And do you think your razor needs a vibrating handle, a flashlight, a back scratcher, and 10 blades? Your handsome-ass grandfather had one blade and polio. Looking good, pop-up! Stop paying for shave tech you don't need. And stop forgetting to buy your blades every month. Alejandro and I are going to ship them right to you. We're not just selling razors. We're also making new jobs. Alejandra, what were you doing last month?
Not working.
What are you doing now?
Working.
I'm no Vanderbilt, but this train makes hay. So stop forgetting to buy your blades every month and start deciding where you're going to stack all those dollar bills I'm saving you. We are DollarShaveClub.com, and the party is on. I know karate. I know jiu-jitsu. I drive like a gangster when I'm coming to see you.
The following program contains coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other thing, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it on to our children in the bloodstream. The only way they can inherit the freedom we have known is if we fight for it, protect it, defend it, and then hand it to them with the well-taught lessons of how they in their lifetime must do the same.
The tax man is coming! The tax man is coming! Oh, wait, that's not how that line's supposed to go. Anyway, welcome into the program, ladies and gentlemen. This is the Jen and Rick Show. I am Rick, she is Jen, and we are live, and it's Thursday. We do this thing usually every Thursday night, somewhere around 10 p.m. Eastern-ish, if Skype cooperates, because it wasn't. But we're here. Damn gremlins. Anyway, so how are you, Jen? How are you?
Doing okay, other than the whole having a kid homesick from school all week. That's never fun. And I'm single parenting because the husband's out of town. So thankfully, we did do our taxes before he had to leave before all this hit. So, I've just been hunkered down at home with bad weather and a sick kid. So there you go. But things are looking up for the weekend.
Yeah, I have not done my taxes yet. That will probably be Saturday. But I procrastinated this year because now that I do a lot of freelance work, I had to go up to the next package with the H&R Block software. Yes. So I was like, I kind of felt the pucker.
And you know how much of that I've done in the past between choreography and teaching and then also all my events. Coordinating and venue management, you know, I would have my salary job, but then I'd also be hired freelance, you know, a contract for various events and things. And then of course, as choreographer, judge, or private dance teacher, all of that would be contract work as well. So it used to get very complicated. My husband has a salary job, but also is a musician, also does production, you know, so we would have all these things coming in. The last year, we did not have as much of that, but typically it has been a little complicated, but all my family are like musicians and performers, well, of my immediate family. So my poor father, thankfully he is a CPA. So he has, he's been offering his free services to us long before he ever knew how hard we were going to make him work.
Yeah, unfortunately I have become my extended family's tax preparer too. So I actually have kind of considered hanging my own shingle. For a couple months out of the year, be like, yeah, I'll do them, but it's going to cost you now.
Right. Anyway. Well, it's funny because the ones that are the most complicated, part of that problem is they sometimes you're getting your paperwork later than you do for the simpler ones. So there are ones where he starts to tell the old folks, my grandparents and stuff, he's like, hey, y'all are the simplest to do. Can we go ahead and give me all the info so that we can go ahead and start getting that done, you know, in February or March? Get that out of the way, because I'm going to have to work on the kiddos for the next 2 months, and it's going to be a nightmare. But it does. It saves us a little money, and he works diligently to get it right, because he absolutely wants us to get the most out of our money and to not be screwed over in any way by the government, which obviously we will talk about with our guest this evening.
Yeah, speaking of which, we should probably get ready to bring the first one on since we're cramming back-to-back in tonight. So we're going to go ahead and get things squared away, take a quick break, bring our first guest on. And like I said, we're going to be doing guests pretty much back-to-back. So it's going to be quick break, guest, quick break, guest. And then if we have any time left, we'll talk a little more at the end. But you know how we do things. When we have guests, we like to let the guests talk. And when we have guests, I like to let Jen do most of the talking to the guests because, well, reasons.
You like to put all the pressure on me.
Well, yeah, you know. I mean, come on. That's how I talked you into doing this in the first place, right? Remember?
I know. It's kind of how you work with me. It's fine. I don't mind.
All right, folks, like I said, we're going to take a quick break, come back, get things reset with our guests that will be joining us this evening. So you guys hang out for just a minute. You got a couple minutes, so if you need to run and grab a quick drink, you can. But we'll be right back, so don't go too far. You are listening to The Jen and Rick Show live on KLRNradio.com. We'll be right back.
I'm Jordan Klinger, an attorney at McIntyre Law. The decision to hire an attorney after you've been injured is important. The decision on who to hire is even more important. At McIntyre Law, we will settle a case if the offer to our client is fair. Partial justice is no justice at all. At McIntyre Law, we are committed to obtaining full justice for our clients. Contact McIntyre Law at 405-917-5200 or visit us at McIntyreLaw.com.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
I am Conor McGregor, multiple weight MMA champion. I'm a fighter and I've been through many battles in the octagon. Many consider my fights in the octagon heroic, but the real life heroes are those men and women who fight to protect us every day. The real life fighters, the real life heroes, are the firefighters and police officers. These first responders are true heroes, because these brave men and women put themselves in the line of danger every single day, protecting us all. The Tunnel to Towers Foundation ensures that first responders from fire, EMS and police departments who are killed in the line of duty with young children have a home without the burden of a mortgage. They are my heroes. They need our help today. I'd like to ask you to join me in donating $11 a month to support their efforts. Your $11 a month honors and supports our first responders. Please call now at 1-844-BRAVEST or visit tunneltotowers.org.
At the LASIK Vision Institute, we know LASIK is a big decision, and every one of our patients is unique. That's why we customize your LASIK journey to you.
I only have a certain budget.
No problem. Right now at the LASIK Vision Institute, get 20% off LASIK when treated in April. That can be over $900 off when treating both eyes, plus guaranteed financing options. So visit GetLVILASIK.com today to start your journey towards 20/20 vision. Must mention this promotion to be treated in April of 2024 to qualify. 20% off standard price of Wavelight procedure. Cannot be combined with any other offers. Go to GetLVILASIK.com for details. At the LASIK Vision Institute, we know LASIK is a big decision, and every one of our patients is unique. That's why we customize your LASIK journey to you.
I'm so busy right now.
We offer a mix of convenient days and times, including 30-minute virtual appointments to fit your schedule.
I would love it, but I have astigmatism.
We treat thousands of patients with astigmatism every month with great outcomes. The LASIK Vision Institute is making your journey towards 20/20 vision all about you. So visit GetLVILASIK.com today to start your LASIK journey.
The following program contains coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
And welcome back into the program, ladies and gentlemen. Again, this is the Jen and Rick Show. I'm Rick. She's Jen, and as promised, we have guests, so I'm going to turn things over to her, because she's better with interviews than I am. But don't tell her I said so. Take it away, Jen.
Yeah, so we have David Williams with us today. He's the president of the Taxpayers Protection Alliance, and we're so excited to have him as we're leading up to tax day. I know everybody's really working on their taxes. Maybe you were very proactive and filed early, but I know a lot of people don't. And it's a constant cause for concern and kind of angst, especially in the current economic climate. So I'd like, David, if you just go ahead and give us a little bit of an overview about Taxpayers Protection Alliance, what you do, what the goals are, kind of what you're involved in. And so we can kind of get a grasp on how your organization is helping advocate for the taxpayers.
Sure thing, and thank you very much for having me. Taxpayers Protection Alliance, we are a government watchdog. We look at transparency issues, we look at spending, we look at taxation. We're also a consumer watchdog as we look at what the government is doing that either benefits or harms consumers. And there's a lot of things that they do that harm consumers. So really what we do is we're nonpartisan. We call balls and strikes, right? If it's good for taxpayers, you know, we promote that. If it's not, we try to stop that from happening. So, you know, I've been doing this for a number of years. I mean, personally, I've been doing this for since 1993, so a long time. And I actually created a Taxpayers Protection Alliance 13 years ago. And I've seen a lot of good, mostly bad, though, with the government when it comes to taxing and spending.
Yeah, I was going to ask you what your background was that kind of led you to TPA.
Yeah, I was at another taxpayer organization for 18 years, and this has really become a passion of mine. It's amazing that I started this in 1993, and I just, you know, from that day forward, it's really important to have a voice for the taxpayer. And, you know, I talked a little bit about, you know, we have a lot of bad days when we're taxpayers, but, you know, there are some good days. And I remember back in 2005, the Bridge to Nowhere in Alaska, this earmark that just wasn't necessary, wasn't needed, was supported by a very powerful member of Congress at that time, Senator Ted Stevens. And we were able to get rid of that earmark as a $435 million earmark. Very symbolic. Wow. To be able to get rid of, you know, a massive project like that. And, you know, it's really, and I remember that. I mean, it's been a long time ago that that's happened, but I remember back to that. And I think to myself, you know, why can't we do that again when it comes to taxes or spending, is get people's attention and really advocate for better government.
Right. And I think with, I do think too, though, with anything having to do with taxes, I think the general public, obviously there are those of us that are more politically engaged, that are more involved in kind of wanting to be more vocal about government waste, about, you know, being on behalf of actual taxpaying citizens. But for, I think for the general public, it's kind of intimidating. They're overwhelmed by the thought of it, particularly if they have a little bit more of a complex tax filing situation. You know, a lot of people in today's world are not just having their salary W-2 job. They're having to supplement with side jobs that might be various 1099s that come with all the sorts of little, you know, stipulations on them and how you file. And so I think people just get extremely overwhelmed. And so then they kind of tune this stuff out. It's like, oh, well, like that's above my pay grade. And I think it's important to have organizations and outreach and then even our politicians speaking very frankly on this to kind of make them understand that, like, it doesn't have to be. Yes, it's a complicated tax code. Yes, it can be daunting, but there's a lot that you can do to advocate for yourself, and that there are a lot of services out there. And that brings me to the whole direct file thing. There are a lot of services out there that are not the IRS's service that you can use to help grasp and simplify your own taxes and understand them better so you know what you're voting for.
Yeah, taxes are very complex and very intimidating, to be sure. And you have the chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee. This is the committee that writes tax policy. So they're supposed to know everything about tax policy, the ins and outs. Well, they use an accountant to file their taxes. So, I mean, this is how intimidating the system really is that the people writing the laws have to use an accountant because it's so complex. And people are afraid. People are afraid if they make a mistake, they're going to be audited. And we've heard that, you know, the IRS wants to audit the billionaires and the millionaires. The problem is, the reality is that that's not who they audit. And reports have been done, studies have been done, and it's shown that the IRS actually audits lower income folks at a higher pace than it does higher income folks. And the reason is that they know they can intimidate someone on the lower income scale. If you're Bill Gates, you have a team of attorneys, a team of CPAs that will work. If you are making $50,000 or $60,000 a year, you don't have that. What you are is you're going up against the Internal Revenue Service, the IRS, and they have the resources to go after folks. And that's where I get frustrated, is that they are going after the lower income folks when it comes to audits. And that's not good for anybody. And again, it's the weight of the government versus, you know, the little guy.
Right. And I think it kind of goes back to that old meme of where it's like, so I owe the government money. Yes, those are your taxes. Those pay for your public services, yada, yada, yada. And they go, okay, so tell me how much do I owe? Well, it depends on your income. Okay, here's my income. Tell me how much I know. No, you've got to come up with it and tell me. Okay, but if you get it wrong, you go to jail. So it's like, that is so, you know, intimidating to people. And of course, it's a little more, that's a very simplistic view of it, but it does seem that way. It's like, give me the number. And they're like, no, you don't get the number. You have to figure the number out and hope you get it right so that we don't come after you. And that's just like government in a nutshell about so many things. But when it comes to filing, and I'm lucky, I'm the daughter of a CPA and CFO, so I always have free free tax advice and services at my fingertips. But I know for a lot of people talking about this direct file situation, and I know it's just a pilot program in 12 states right now, you know, it focuses on the really simple returns. You know, you can't file if you have 1099s or if you have certain levels of interest income coming in. But I just wonder, like, how many people understand that when you go to a private, firm or any other, even if it's a free service provided, but it's provided within the free market, within private business, you know, knowing that they are going to actually advocate for your interests versus if you go to the IRS, how much do you think the government is going to advocate for you to not pay them more?
Yeah, direct
like
file.
It's a very obvious situation.
it is. And direct file is this new program by the IRS where they prepare your taxes. So basically, they're figuring out what you owe or what kind of refund you're going to get. Now, you know, the obvious question is, who is looking out for the interest of the taxpayer, especially when it comes to a refund? Is it going to be the IRS who is trying to maximize revenue? Or is it going to be a private company or, you know, the local guy, the local CPA, right? They're the ones that are going to look out for you and try to say, they're going to ask you the questions. Well, did you donate any clothing? Did you, you know, did you do this? Did you do that? So those are the questions that that private person or industry is going to ask. But the IRS, they don't care. They don't care about that. They care about maximizing the revenue into the IRS. And I saw a tweet by Senator Elizabeth Warren, I think it was today or, you know, just recently I saw this tweet, and she said $30 million has been given out in refunds through direct file. My question was, well, how much should have been given out in refunds?
Right.
If a private, you know, a firm had done this, it could have been a lot more. So obviously that's not the whole story that she's telling. And that's my concern, is that the gaslighting goes on day in and day out from Congress. And that was a perfect example of that. And the IRS should not be in the business of preparing your taxes. There
right.
is an inherent conflict of interest in that.
Yeah. And I've seen a lot of people point to it being, you know, going as so far as to say that they think it's actually unconstitutional for them to be engaged in this with citizens. And I think, you know, going back to your point of saying, you know, advocating for you, are they asking you the right questions about all your things? And I think there are a lot of people, you know, I'm an older millennial, but I'm a millennial. And I know I had a lot of friends that once they started kind of having to do this, their own thing with this, that didn't realize that they could, you know, deduct certain things that contributed to their employment. They didn't know about, for example, like you said, donating clothing, like, okay, I go donate my clothing to Goodwill and Savers or, you know, any of these types of places, and they hand you that note back that, you know, keep those and you can file those, and it may make a little bit of a difference here or there. Certain other credits that you might be eligible for that they didn't really know. And if they're just going through something like this, I'm not sure. I have zero faith that the IRS is going to be helping them out to point out that they're missing out on some of these very legal kind of what some people call loopholes, but they're legal credits for you to maximize within your filings of your profession.
All I can say about the IRS helping with taxes is I'm reminded of the famous quote from Ronald Reagan, you know, the nine scariest words in the English language. Pretty sure those apply here. Just saying.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm from the government and I'm here to help. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that's right. And also the creation of this program. I mean, we're talking about a software program, and the IRS has software and hardware that is 40 to 50 years old, and they're trying to create a whole new program, and they don't even have an accurate cost estimate of what it's going to take to create this new program, this new software. So remember during healthcare.gov, that rollout, billions of dollars for what they said was going to be a simple, you know, healthcare website. Well, they're saying this is a simple tax preparation website. Well, it's going to cost billions of dollars, and we don't have the cost estimate of that. So there are a lot of costs to the individual taxpayer, but also to society as a whole.
Yeah, it's kind of the age old kind of problem with government, right? That they can't quite give the right estimate, and then they way overspend anyone that they give, and it's still not a functioning product that is truly beneficiary to the American public. How do you think that, in kind of along those lines of blown budgets, the 87,000 new IRS agents that were, you know, approved?
Scares me. It scares me on a number of levels. First is the cost of these new agents, because there's nothing, you know, as permanent as a temporary job when it comes to government. And you know, we'll have 87,000 new people working for the IRS, regardless of what they're doing. This is going to increase the cost of the Internal Revenue Service, you know, by tens of billions of dollars, and we're not going to be able to backtrack from that. What agency has ever gotten smaller versus gotten bigger? They've always gotten bigger. So, and this is going to really bolster their budget. But then what are they going to do when they get in there? A lot of them are agents. The majority of these folks are agents that are going to be out, and they're going to be auditing. And as I mentioned earlier, auditing lower income folks. So you have that problem. And the IRS, they need reform from top to bottom. They need new computer systems. Their IT is way outdated, yet they're spending money on agents, on audits. They have security problems. There are massive privacy leaks that are happening through the IRS that we don't know who's doing it. People have not been arrested. So there are so many problems inside the IRS. And just giving the money doesn't solve problems. Listen, if giving money to an agency solved problems, we'd have the best education system, the federal education system in the world. We don't. Yeah. The education system has failed us. So giving the IRS more money does nothing to fix the problems at the IRS.
Well, it not only doesn't fix the problem at the IRS, it also doesn't benefit the actual taxpayers in forms of any kind of actual help or relief. Like you said, it just becomes a more burdensome bureaucracy that goes after middle to low income citizens. And they're the ones that desperately need this help, which I know is part of what we're waiting on the Senate to help with the Tax Relief for American Families and Workers Act, to see if they will actually act on this legislation at all. What is a TPA's stance on that?
Well, we were thrilled when the House passed this legislation, because what it does, it extends the 2017 tax cuts, or a group of these tax cuts from 2017, and extends them past 2025. But the Senate has not brought this up, and it's really, really frustrating. And, you know, going back to 2017, what an amazing moment in the history of this country when we had this tax reform. It's because it lowered rates for middle-class earners. It cut the corporate rate, and we saw the economy just take off. And I heard stories from small businesses who said, I am hiring more people because I have more money. I can hire, I can expand my business. We heard about, you know, big, you know, corporations sending out $1,000 bonus checks to their employees. And I also remember a certain Nancy Pelosi making fun of that, saying, oh, what's $1,000? Are you kidding me? $1,000 is a lot of money. Right. To people, you know, just trying to get by. And boy, especially today with inflation, I think everyone would love a $1,000 bonus. But it shows the disconnect that Congress has with the American people when Nancy Pelosi mocks and completely downplays a bonus of $1,000.
Right. Well, this is the same woman who continued to get her salon style hair care and everything else throughout the pandemic when she was lecturing everybody else on how to behave. And otherwise they're killing grandmas. But I think that, yeah, that's really is such the big problem why I feel like there's often a lack of urgency on this, on measures like this, because it's just not as urgent to them as it is to the regular person. And I think the same goes for, you know, Democrats have typically been a little bit, particularly lately, have leaned more anti-capitalist, anti-business. And Republicans have been pro-business, but particularly pro-small business. And in actual, you know, American culture, it's pretty popular to be pro-small business, whether you're left or right. That's kind of been a thing across the board. So the politicians, you know, the Democratic politicians are a little out of touch on that. And acts like this seem to directly benefit those small businesses that we all claim to love and want to protect and uphold. And they can't do that if they don't get some relief in the same way that the lower and middle class Americans can't continue to have upward mobility unless they get some tax relief as well.
Yeah, small businesses are the lifeblood of this country. I mean, yeah, tens of millions of people are employed by small businesses. And that's who we need to help. And listen, obviously, big business is also an important part of this country, but it's really the small businesses that, you know, for me, they're the lifeblood of this. And when you talk about not getting a big refund from the IRS, taxes going up, it all adds to inflation. And the fact that we've had, you know, more, you know, 20% inflation over the, you know, past 3 years when Biden took office, you know, people are feeling this real financial impact, and they need something. They need, whether it's a, you know, $400 or $500, you know, refund check from the IRS, they need something. They need some relief, and they don't need Senator Elizabeth Warren gaslighting them, saying how great the direct file program is,
among many other things that she says that are rather anti-American and abhorrent. Well, thank you so much. Why don't you let everybody know a little bit, like, where can we find you on social media? Anything else you'd like to tell us before we head out?
So we're at Protect Taxpayers on X, used to be Twitter, and we're online at protectingtaxpayers.org. And I implore everybody that if you don't like something that you see that's happening in Congress, call your member of Congress. Please call, make your voice heard, because that's where the change is going to be made, is making sure that your member of Congress knows that you're disappointed and dissatisfied with what they're doing.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for taking the time, David. And I'm sure everybody is anxiously awaiting how the Senate's going to act, but also just hoping that they get their filings right come this tax day next week. Thanks for giving us some more information. And everybody, go look at the organization, because they've got a lot of information on there that's very helpful and useful. So thanks again, David.
Thank you.
All right, folks. Well, that was guest number one. So we're going to take another quick break, get things set up for guest number two. Because, you know, Jen and I are both workaholics, and it's been forever ago since our last meetings. Anyway, that's mainly for me. I can't really speak for her. But y'all know how hard she works on stuff, too. So I'm pretty sure I'm not speaking out of turn. All right, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we have another guest from the same group trying to save your bacon and keep you away from those 87,000 newly minted and some of which are armed IRS agents. Things are scary all over, man. Things are scary all over. We'll be right back. Stay tuned.
I am Conor McGregor, multiple weight MMA champion. I'm a fighter and I've been through many battles in the octagon. Many consider my fights in the octagon heroic, but the real life heroes are those men and women who fight to protect us every day.
The real-life fighters, the real-life heroes, are the firefighters and police officers. These first responders are true heroes because these brave men and women put themselves in the line of danger every single day, protecting us all. The Tunnel to Towers Foundation ensures that first responders from fire, EMS and police departments who are killed in the line of duty with young children have a home without the burden of a mortgage. They are my heroes. They need our help today. I'd like to ask you to join me in donating $11 a month to support their efforts. Your $11 a month honors and supports our first responders. Please call now at 1-844-BRAVEST or visit tunneltotowers.org.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
I'm Jordan Klinger, an attorney at McIntyre Law. The decision to hire an attorney after you've been injured is important. The decision on who to hire is even more important. At McIntyre Law, we will settle a case if the offer to our client is fair. Partial justice is no justice at all. At McIntyre Law, we are committed to obtaining full justice for our clients. Contact McIntyre Law at 405-917-5200 or visit us at McIntyreLaw.com.
At the LASIK Vision Institute, we know LASIK is a big decision, and every one of our patients is unique. That's why we customize your LASIK journey to you.
I only have a certain budget.
No problem. Right now at the LASIK Vision Institute, get 20% off LASIK when treated in April. That can be over $900 off when treating both eyes, plus guaranteed financing options. So visit GetLVILASIK.com today to start your journey towards 20/20 vision. Must mention this promotion and be treated in April of 2024 to qualify. 20% off standard price of wavelight procedure. Cannot be combined with any other offers. Go to GetLVILASIK.com for details. At the LASIK Vision Institute, we know LASIK is a big decision, and every one of our patients is unique. That's why we customize your LASIK journey to you.
I'm so busy right now.
We offer a mix of convenient days and times, including 30-minute virtual appointments to fit your schedule.
I would love it, but I have astigmatism.
We treat thousands of patients with astigmatism every month with great outcomes. The LASIK Vision Institute is making your journey towards 20/20 vision all about you. So visit GetLVILASIK.com today to start your LASIK journey.
The following program contains coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
We're still alive. My bad. Welcome back into the program. Again, this is an unusual night for Jen and I. We have back-to-back guests, so we're going to get to the second guest right now. And as I stated earlier, I'm going to turn things over to her. But again, don't tell her she's better at interviews than I am. I have low self-esteem, man. Take it away, Jen.
Welcome back, everybody. We have Patrick Hedger here with us, who is also with the Taxpayers Protection Alliance. He's the executive director. So, Patrick, thank you for being with us today. And why don't you, David, and he already kind of gave us an overview of TPA, but why don't we start with kind of your background and what led you to be working with TPA?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for having me. So I really got started in working in public policy and economics because of sitting at the dinner table with my father. My father was a small business manufacturer here in the United States. And every night at the dinner table, I always heard about how he was far more concerned with what the government was going to do to him than what his competitors were doing. And I saw firsthand how overtaxation and overregulation inhibited his ability to grow his business and succeed. And that inspired me to kind of get into the work that I do now. And I've made a nice career for myself complaining. Background, degree in government international politics, as well as a master's degree in public policy from Folsom George Mason. Worked at the Freedom Works Foundation, the Charles Koch Institute, the Competitive Enterprise Institute, and now happy to be part of the Taxpayers Protection Alliance.
Very cool. I can sort of relate to you on a different side of things sitting around a dinner table. My father was a CPA and CFO, so he was constantly trying to figure out and navigate the complicated tax structures for individuals as well as corporations all throughout his career. And of course, that also means I get free tax services all my life, as do most of our family from him. But for those that do not have that access, of course, they're trying to navigate this very complicated tax code and figuring out, you know, kind of how the different administrations affect them. So on that, what do you think about the current climate with the leftovers from kind of Trump years, if there's anything at all, or has it all gone away and expired? And then the current Bidenomics and the effects that the average taxpayer can expect to see and feel?
Yeah, so fortunately for now, most of the provisions of the TCJA are still in place, though many are starting to expire and many will expire in 2025. Some of the bigger things that we liked out of the TCJA are still in place, which is a lower corporate tax rate. We know corporate taxes are disproportionately passed on to workers and consumers and not actually paid by the corporations themselves. So it's important that that stays as low as possible. But the Biden administration is working to raise the corporate tax rate and also institute a global minimum tax as well on corporations, which of course will be passed on to consumers. But really, the big problems that we see with the tax code, and the reason why it's so great that you get free tax advice, but others are paying for tax advice, is that the tax code is extremely complicated. And the government, instead of spending money or passing specific bills to regulate the economy, likes to regulate the economy through the tax code, regulate behavior through the tax code. And that makes it incredibly complicated and onerous to deal with. One of the great things that the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act under the Trump administration did was significantly raise the standard deduction, which made tax compliance a lot easier for most people. Even folks with, you know, mortgages at a certain level, wouldn't need to itemize their deductions, which really creates complexity in the tax code. The standard deduction went so high that you could just claim that and get more money back than you would itemizing your deductions. But that really just gets at the big problem that whatever you want to talk about with regards to tax policy or how to prepare your taxes or should it be free, should it be, you know, should you have to pay somebody, comes down to the fact that the tax code is extremely complicated. It's hard to understand. And Congress has done that on purpose. And everything else is treating symptoms instead of getting at the underlying problem.
Right. And I think for a lot of people, because it's so complicated, and we talked about this a little bit with David, you know, the average person gets overwhelmed and so therefore kind of tunes it out because they feel like this is impossible for me to understand. This is way over my head. You know, nothing I can do about it. So I've just got to go pay someone to help me because there's absolutely no change I can make and nothing I can do. And I think, you know, obviously, there are hot button issues that are at the top of everybody's list and obviously the media's list when it comes to electing our politicians. But really, this should be one of the most fundamental things that you look into before voting for somebody.
Yeah, absolutely. And another reason why folks are, you know, want to wash their hands of it is because the stakes are extremely high. And that if you make a mistake trying to get the money that you're properly owed back into your pocket, you potentially face criminal penalties. I mean, nobody likes getting a notice from the IRS. I remember last year I had to file an extension and I got terrified. I got a letter in the mail from the IRS, had the IRS's return address on it. I was just terrified to open it. And I opened it and it was just a letter confirming that they approved my extension. People shouldn't have that
experience.
I've gotten
one of those scary letters too. I've gotten one of those scary letters too, and it was thicker than it needed to be because they just repeated the same things in like four different pieces of paper, including English, Spanish, and something I can't remember, but it was like that envelope looked really thick when I got it, and I was absolutely terrified. Called my dad, was like, I got something from the IRS. I don't know what it is, you know, and like the fact that it just even invokes that kind of fear in someone when you have been doing your due diligence, you're trying to be, you know, a tax-paying, law-abiding citizen, really speaks to kind of the outrageous, you know, power and control that the IRS has. and the fear that they can kind of inflict on anybody at any given moment. And I think that is something that just everyday citizens are just, we kind of go back to that meme of like, okay, you owe money. Okay, tell me how much I know. Oh no, you have to figure it out. Okay, well, what if I don't do it right? Well, you go to jail or you get fined. Like, that's not okay.
Right. And, you know, it's easy to blame the IRS. At the same time, the IRS is overwhelmed by the complexity of its job as well. Multiple reports out of the Government Accountability Office have found that the IRS, whether it's at its call centers or at its in-person centers, is routinely giving out incorrect information. That is, if you can get a hold of somebody to begin with. So the IRS has an overwhelming task on its hands. Congress hasn't made its life any easier. And unfortunately, what we see is that when funds are appropriated to the IRS, they use that funding to go after low-hanging fruit instead of taking on the tasks that are truly necessary to improve the S part of the IRS, which is the service part. They instead dedicate resources to going after low-hanging fruit, low-income folks, middle-income folks now that aren't in tax compliance, and auditing those folks because it's cheaper to audit those people and because they don't have the resources to fight back. So that's really the kind of the big concern that we have with some of the recent changes we've seen with the Biden administration and recent spending going into the IRS, is that it's not going towards, again, improving that S part of the IRS, of making it a service versus a law enforcement agency.
Right, which is kind of goes into this whole situation with the approval of 87,000 new IRS agents, and then some of the statements coming out saying that, well, we have to do this and this because they need to be trained, and then a good chunk of them need to be armed. So that does lend most people to go, wait, what? Why does an IRS agent need to have the ability to be armed? What are they actually doing here? And that does make it seem more like law enforcement as opposed to a service.
Yeah, it's really concerning. And there's also just concerns about IRS infrastructure as well, cybersecurity, the protection of sensitive data. I mean, the IRS has the most sensitive data imaginable on political organizations and individuals. And what we've seen is several cases over the last few years of IRS leaking data, as well as the GAO has found that the IRS has not been instituting best cybersecurity practices. And now you have the IRS, instead of addressing those glaring concerns, well-documented concerns about having outdated technology and not doing proper cybersecurity practices, is trying to we have an IRS that can't walk properly, and now it's trying to chew gum and trying to supplant tax preparation services that are out there. The IRS is now a software company that is trying to compete with the likes of Intuit and TaxSlayer and H&R Block. And, you know, say what you want about that policy. It would be nice if the IRS was accomplishing its core mission better before it started taking on new tasks.
Right. And you know, I know with this whole direct file situation, I know that TPA has released several statements about it, but that GAO, the Government Accountability Office, also has released a report regarding that program. And it's basically that they cannot support anything that the IRS itself can't support what it's trying to claim as far as the data analysis and cost estimates for the direct file program. And they're just kind of acting a little bit like the healthcare.gov launch site situation, where it was like, just be quiet and we'll do it and we're rolling it out and we can't tell you what it costs. And also now it doesn't really work, but we're going to pour millions and millions more into it until it finally does. With no real accountability for how much that's going to cost the taxpayer in order to supposedly help the taxpayer. I mean, this is the IRS, and there's zero accountability on basically the startup costs they've just pretty much ignored entirely and will not have any transparency on, which is really concerning.
Yeah, from the get-go, this pilot program for the IRS basically to create its own version of TaxSlayer or TurboTax, Congress only appropriated money for the IRS to study the idea. And the IRS got that money and just launched it. They released a study that said exactly what they wanted to hear and launched the program anyway. And that's really concerning, that you have an administration that is basically going well beyond what Congress has asked for, right? The executive is supposed to execute the law, not create it itself. And this is just yet another example of government overreach. But certainly, yeah, the GAO has released a report saying that they've massively underreported how much this could potentially cost. We've also got reporting showing that uptake has been pretty minimal. You only have in the tens of thousands of people, which on a base of, you know, several hundred million taxpayers is not great. It's not great uptake. And it's really confusing because there are already programs in place to help people with simple taxes file for free. There is, there's a direct file program, but it often gets confused with free file. Free file outsources it to the private sector and does a pretty good job. That is utilized by tens of millions of people.
Right. And I mean, as we've seen time and time again, no matter how much the bureaucracies want it to not be true and the administrations and the lifelong government heads want it to not be true, you know, the private sector almost 100% of the time does it better than some government conglomerate can ever do in almost any basic task on this planet. So it just seems like a no-brainer to me. But I know there's also the concern of the ability for the IRS to help the average taxpayer when their goal is to maximize their revenue. So, you know, there's a lot of conflict here, and not just on their transparency, but also on them even being involved in this business to begin with, when they're the ones that have to be holding people accountable as well.
Yeah, it's a big problem you see throughout bureaucracy, and it's happening at the IRS as well, where you've basically got all three branches of government within one federal agency. And that's really concerning when it comes to tax prep, because yes, the IRS's job is to maximize revenue. It is to generate revenue. And it's a question of that we don't really have the answers to, of if you file directly with the IRS, they prepare your taxes for you. What happens if you get audited? Who comes to your defense? Who is held accountable there? And how do you have any sort of, where's the market incentive for them to make sure you're getting as much revenue back as you're owed? Right. Tax prep companies benefit directly. You know, there's a direct incentive there for them to make sure you get as much money back as possible, because that way you keep coming back to them every single year. That just doesn't exist with the IRS. And we still have, again, open-ended questions of, if you do a direct file with the IRS, what are your liability protections if your taxes end up being incorrect or you get audited?
Right. Yeah, there's a lot of big concerns here, which obviously there kind of always are with anything that the government takes over. But particularly with the sort of, you know, IRS is kind of the boogeyman of a lot of government agencies in that regard, of kind of the effect it has when the name is said around regular tax paying citizens. So even more so there than say, like, you know, even talking about Obamacare or something like that. So moving forward, you have, I guess, what are your kind of biggest concerns facing taxpaying citizens, you know, if we get four more years of this administration?
Oh, gosh, where to start? Really, I think there's a, you know, getting away from kind of talking about the nuts and bolts of tax policy and the IRS, I think there's a theme that we're seeing with this administration. Whether it is at SEC or FCC or FTC, any of the three-letter agencies, IRS included, there is a major mission creep that we see, where we've got agencies that are going well beyond their congressional mandates and trying to regulate aspects of the economy that they're really not designed to do. And they're regulating in a way that supplants objective metrics with subjective metrics, right? So that is basically trying to impose value judgments versus basic enforcement of environmental laws or our securities laws, things like that. We've got, for example, a great example is the Securities and Exchange Commission, a financial regulator, is just finished promulgating a rule on regulating carbon emissions. Now, say what you want about regulating carbon emissions, we have an EPA. Why is the SEC doing that? We also see this in the antitrust venues as well, where you've got Department of Justice cases and Federal Trade Commission cases that are going after companies and asking companies questions about the composition of their corporate boards, whether their workforces are unionized, basically progressive policy goals unrelated to whether or not a merger or acquisition is going to raise prices for consumers, which is an objective metric. So that's kind of the broad stroke concern that I see with four more years of a Biden administration.
Yeah, and I think it's the tip of the iceberg. And I'd urge everybody to go to TPA's website, protectingtaxpayers.org, because they do cover so many issues, including SEC regulations, other regulation, you know, various reforms, all the things facing Congress, including that House-approved tax package that has yet to make it to the Senate floor. But y'all cover so many issues. There's blogs, there's YouTube videos. You know, it's really just a wealth of information. So I'd urge everybody to go and look at that, because I do think too, you know, there's the more, I think people, like I said before, their eyes glaze over. They're kind of like, oh my gosh, I can't do this. I don't know what all this means. But I do think that you all put out a lot of information. I also say to follow you and David on Twitter, because y'all speak very plainly. But you put out a lot of information that's easy to digest. You know, you can get into the nitty gritty of it if you want to click this extra link and do this link and do this extra thing. But you really present the information in a way that anybody can understand. And so I really appreciate that. That's something that I think is really, really valuable to the average public who thinks that they can't understand any of this stuff. And in reality, they can. So we appreciate that. Any last words before we get out of here? And please tell everybody where they can find you and any extra thing you want to tack on here.
Well, gosh, I don't know if I could say anything better than that. I really appreciate the kind words. That's exactly what we try to do, right? The government likes to drag people into the weeds, and that's where they get you. And so we're trying to act like a weed whacker. But just go to our website, www.protectingtaxpayers.org. You can follow us on Twitter, X, whatever he's calling it these days, at Protect Taxpayers. I'm at Pat_Hedger on X Twitter. We're on all the major social media sites, not on TikTok, but on all the other major social media sites. So you can find us there. And we just really appreciate the time.
Absolutely. Well, we look forward to more information going forward, and we might have to have y'all back on again if any of this stuff progresses through Congress or any big changes are made.
Happy to. Thanks for having me.
All right. Well, thank you, Patrick.
All right. Is anybody else's head hurting? I haven't even done my taxes yet. Just having people talk about it is making my eye twitch, my head hurt. But he's already gone. I was going to let him know that right now the running game for Twitter now is people either call it Jitter or Twixter, but I didn't want to interrupt, so.
I just still say Twitter. I don't even get bogged down with it. Every now and then I throw in or X or whatever, but I mean, it's Twitter. That's a really hard rebrand to make. Good luck. Maybe 10 years from now, we'll call it X.
So we only have a couple minutes left anyway, so it doesn't really matter. But what amazes me, right, is everything's been rebranded, but what do you type in to go to the website if you're using a browser?
Right. Also, any of their links that you click, it's twitter.com. So, yeah.
I'm just saying. Yeah, I mean, I get it. Elon's on the spectrum. He's admitted it. And for some reason, a lot of them have fixations with letters. And I've noticed it's disproportionately the letter X for a lot of them that are higher performing on the spectrum, which
it took close to a decade for it to really just be Facebook FB versus the Facebook. I mean, it was the Facebook for a long time, and that was just dropping a word off.
Yeah.
That wasn't changing the whole name. So, you know, that's just the way it goes. So,
then us older people rebelled, and when they took the off, we just started calling it the Book of Faces.
Right, the Book of Faces.
Reasons. But yeah, anyway, so I do want to say you did an amazing job with these guests, and I kind of enjoyed just being able to sit here and chill out, other than the one or two times I got to chime in, so thank you.
Oh, well, thank you. They made it easy, though. They made it easy. They had a lot to talk about, a lot to say, and what TPA is doing and really, like, just go look. You can click issue and how it relates to taxpayers, anything from energy to immigration to, of course, tax policy, but transportation policy, any of these things. And you can go find information and press releases and current legislation, and not just federally, but also in various states, and what their stance is on it, what they're fighting for, and how you can reach your representatives or whoever else and try to make your voice known of what you're for or against. Because a lot of times people just don't even know. They don't even know. And then they hear about it later and they're like, wait, how did that get snuck into that bill? And it's because they were counting on you tuning out because it had something to do with finance, tax, you know, regulatory policy. And you go, bleh, I don't want to hear it. So,
well,
they do a really good job of showing you how it is, you know, very easy to understand, at least on its face, even if the bill is a million pages long, how it's easy to understand what the actual thing is that is being voted on and what the consequences will be for the taxpayers.
All right. So if you're new to keeping up with bills and stuff, let me give you Cliff's Notes 101 on keeping up with con artists, Congress critters. Whatever the name says, it's going to do the opposite. It's pretty straightforward. Inflation Reduction Act did what? Because it's going back up again. Affordable Care Act did what? Because can't nobody afford healthcare anymore again. Anyway.
Yeah.
All right. Well, believe it or not, that's it. We're actually already over time a little bit. And so, I have I have things tomorrow again.
Me too.
It's only Friday. It used to be it's already
it's
Friday.
It's still the week.
No, it's only Friday.
It's still the week. No, it's still the week. We still have a whole weekday left.
I know. Well, I think the only reason I'm dreading it is because Saturday's been set aside as lawn mowing day and tax day. My two least favorite things, and somehow I've gotten them pigeonholed into the same day. This is not good planning.
You did it to yourself. You did it to yourself.
Okay, that sounded a lot like Stacy, and I'm taking it kind of personally. All right. Again, great job. Tell folks where they can find you.
Of course, on all the things that Jay Holmes said, but mostly on Twitter or X or Zitter or whatever anybody's calling it. And then over at Misfit Politics. And, of course, tomorrow night is Misfit Mischief. And again, not sure if it'll be me or our lovely Rex, but one of us will be there to make Twitter fun again. So y'all please join.
Rex Lovely? He might take that personally. Just saying. Anyway. All right.
Darling.
So tomorrow night, I will be hanging out with the lovely Aggie Regan, filling in for the incomparable Mickey Botorch, who is still on extended hiatus, doing He Said, She Said Things. Saturday night, that's Aggie time. 8:30 Eastern. Saturday night, we will have Juxtaposition with myself and the Amish one. I'm gonna send over the notes for the Easter, pre-Easter one. I wanted to do on another one. See which one he wants to run with, since we're behind the show now. Well, other than that, you can find me tomorrow afternoon doing the Rick Robinson show. Pulling my hair out Saturday during the day doing my taxes. I don't know. I really got to stop procrastinating on that stuff. All right. Anyway, you can find me on most social media platforms at RowdyVic73 and contributing daily to Twitchy.com, as well as occasionally on MisfitsPolitics.com and the LoftusPartyPodcast.com. We got to go, though, folks. Have a great rest of your night. Thanks for listening.